everyone. This is Claire Bellerjeau. She is the Director of Education at Ranham Hall Historic House Museum in Oyster Bay. She is quite the expert on the Townsend family and all of the enslaved people that they had in their house and their various properties. I would also say that she's quite the expert on the coal perspiring and a lot of other related topics, including Oyster Bay history. This is her book, Espionage and Enslavement. It tells the story of Liss, and we are here to hear her speak about it tonight. For those of you that are interested, there is a link in the chat where you can go to her website and order a personalized copy since we're unable to have a table at the library. You can also go to her website and ask her whatever questions you are unable to ask. Claire will take quite a few questions tonight, but inevitably you will think of some things afterwards. This is Tiffany. There she is. Hi, Tiffany. Hi, Tiffany's Hello. Daughter. You can see the book right here. She is the co-author, and she has actually also worked on another book that's even probably better known, George Washington's Secret Six. So she has quite a bit of experience working on all things Culper and Robert Townsend and all of these related topics. So without further ado, I will let these two take it away.
Okay. So Tiffany and I have been collaborating on this book. How many years, Tiffany? How many years? Five.
We right? are, yes, over five.
Right. Yes. And we always know how many years because your beautiful daughter that I'm seeing sometimes in the background, she was only 4 months old when we started working together. Yeah. So all we have to do to know how long we've been collaborating on this book is to find Bridget and see how old she is.
That's right.
But as I've said before, it was important for me first to have a professional writer as the co-author. I realized that if this book was going to really work, I needed her help. I also wanted somebody who was a woman. I wanted somebody who was a mother. And I wanted somebody who really already understood the Culper spy ring. And so Tiffany, once again, you were the perfect person. But maybe you could say a few words about what it's been like for you to be on this wild ride.
Well, you know, it's amazing. I love history. That is my mother was an American history teacher. So, you know, I grew up in Virginia, so surrounded by history. That's always been a passion for me. And so a lot of the work that I have done has been in, you know, as a writer, but working in other genres. So when Claire called and I had met her doing the research for Secret Six, and she said, I've got this story and I'd like to talk to you about it. And I'd like to see if you think it could be a thing, because I think there's something really special here. Yeah. And as it turned out, what I found with Claire is whatever Claire says, you know, I've done some research. What it means is I have done the most exhaustive sleuthing detective work imaginable, and I am still going at it. And this is just a fraction of what I've got. And so, you know, she showed me her research, and as, you know, we went on developing this project, she continued to find things. And that was one of the kind of interesting, but also nerve-wracking things was we almost felt like we were in a race against the publisher, because we were just, you know, less than a week out from going to press, and she made one last final little discovery. That's right. So the information that you all have is the most, you know, cutting edge, most newly available research that is available on this topic. And what's fascinating is it really is a story that Claire detected from go. You know, there is nothing else out there written about Liss's story, because this is someone that it's just something Claire followed on a hunch and started pulling a string and then pulling more strings and doing what she does so brilliantly and started making connections and pulling together all these different sources from across North America. Mm-hmm. And so it really is exciting that she was able to help bring this story to light that had truly been silenced for so long.
You know, so many African-American and voices and people of color, their voices, they're part of our American founding story, have been either silenced or just vanished. Mm-hmm. And part of that is because their records are so scarce. And of course, that isn't their fault. That's the fault of our culture in America, that their records were not kept properly or were not kept at all. And so there were many founding figures who were African Americans or people of color. And we don't know their stories because their documents just don't exist. And so when I found these key documents at the East Hampton Library, you know, it was a revelation to me. And then I started realizing, oh my gosh, that's related to this document way over here. And then this one way over here. And that's how I got drawn into this journey. And it's exciting to bring you on this journey tonight. So maybe I should start, right? Maybe I should start with my slides and with my talk. And just as you hear me talking and look at these pictures, you can write a question in the chat, or you can write it on a piece of paper, because you're gonna see a lot tonight. And some of what you see might be brand new to you. It might be brand new information. And so just keep a running list of your questions. And if we don't get them all answered tonight, please reach out to us, okay? Okay, so again, thank you for coming to this book talk tonight. We're here because after more than 16 years of research, I've uncovered the life of an enslaved woman. Her name was Elizabeth, and her nickname was Liss. So together with Tiffany, my co-author, we've written her story. And after so many years of waiting, I can finally share that with the world. Now, everything that I'm going to talk about tonight is not going to be everything that's in the book, but I will introduce you to this extraordinary person and her journey, and that's going to start with her birth. So she was born in Oyster Bay, Long Island, around the year 1763, and she spent her childhood here, enslaved in the home of the Townsend family. And this is what the house looks like now. Now it is Raynham Hall Museum. So I'm so fortunate that Liss has a birthplace museum that you can visit. Now, the world she was born into was very different than what we learned in school. The world she was born into had legal slavery in every one of the 13 colonies. In the colony she was born into, New York, there was more slavery than any colony north of Maryland. By the time Liss was just 7 years old, New York had more slavery than all of the New England colonies combined. If you look at this map, you'll see that in 1770, New York had more slavery than Georgia. Now, generations before she was born, in 1730, New York passed a law that every town will have a paid slave whipper. Every town on Long Island, your town, my town, had a slave whipper and a whipping post in the center of town. Now, in Oyster Bay, we had a slave whipper in 1714. So many years before that law. There was a blacksmith in Oyster Bay who you could pay to put an iron collar on a slave, iron shackles on their arms. If you look at this ledger book that Raynham Hall has in their archives, there are so many notations on this page. The one that you're reading is way down here, just a small little notation on the page. But what a horrific, horrific act. You could pay that same blacksmith to strap a black person who was enslaved to a wagon wheel to be beaten. This is a form of a medieval torture called breaking on the wheel. And if you notice, there's an extra charge for the 12 nails that it took to do that horrible torture. In Liss's world, runaway slave ads appeared in every edition of the paper, and this is just one. This is a Mr. John Townsend who's trying to recover his runaway slave named Isaac. Isaac, it says, is 5 feet 10 inches high, well-made, about a middle age, and has resided about a year at Oyster Bay and has passed himself as free. This man has tried to become a free person by claiming he is free. He gave himself a last name, Isaac Johnston. It says he's very ragged. His coat is light and patched with different colors. He's pockmarked, speaks quick and stammers, and might be secreting himself at Cold Spring Harbor. This was also the world that Robert Townsend was born into in 1753. The Townsends were a large and very wealthy merchant family. They had many shipping concerns. The father, Samuel, and mother, Sarah, had 10 children, 8 of whom survived infancy, and this included 5 sons, Solomon, Samuel Jr., Robert, William, and David, and 3 daughters, Audrey, Sally, and Phoebe. This isn't a painting of the Townsends, but it's a contemporary painting, so you can see what they might have looked like. But it was their third son, Robert, who would become the famous one, the best known, at least in modern times, because in the 1920s, it was discovered that he had been a spy for George Washington, operating under the name Culper Jr. That was discovered because of his beautiful handwriting. So at Raynham Hall Museum, these were the stories that we always told. The story of a revolutionary era family, a patriot father, a son who was a member of the Culper spy ring, and a family whose house became British headquarters during the Revolutionary War. Maybe that would have always been the story of Raynham Hall. But by chance, in 2005, the phone rang. It was an auction house in New York City called Swan Galleries, and they just wanted to let us know they had something going up for sale. A Bible. They thought we'd want to bid on it. We told them that we had a lot of Bibles. Maybe we didn't need another one. And they said, well, I think you're going to want this one. Well, they were right. We bought it for $10,000. And that's because this Bible had something in it that completely changed our story. We had no idea that there were enslaved people that were living in the household, that were owned by the Townsends. But this Bible proved that there were many. It had names like Jeffrey, Catherine, Lily, Susanna, Harry, Susan, Rachel, Violet, Hannah, another Susanna, Mary Ann, Jane, and Gabriel. And it told us things about these people, the day they were born or the year they were born, some of them when they died, even how they died, and some of them it explains how they're related to one another. So even on this one page, there was so much information. And then there was a second page as well that spoke about Nancy, Kate, Jim, and Josh. And on this page, it really said explicitly that these were slaves belonging to Samuel Townsend of Oyster Bay. For years, I worked to understand this unique record and to uncover the lives of other people who were also enslaved there, people who weren't listed in that Bible. And I found many of them, so many: John, William, Jacob, Priscilla, Amos Burling. There were even 2 records I discovered that didn't have any names listed, one for a baby and the other for a man, who I call the unnamed child and the unnamed man. But by far the most compelling story, the person who I could never, ever stop thinking about, was Elizabeth, or Liz. The shocking truth was that actually there were these 3 letters from the East Hampton Library who started me, these 3 amazing letters that started me on this journey. The letters from this institution that's hosting us tonight were at the very start of my journey of discovery. And the truth was that there were twice as many members of the towns of the enslaved people as there were members of the Townsend family. The enslaved people there outnumbered the family 2-1. So these 20 individuals represent a large amount of time. And I estimate that they might have had about a dozen enslaved people at any given point in time. So today, the museum has added another room. We've added a slaves' quarter room to be a counterpoint to the fancy bedrooms where the family lived. We don't have any evidence that enslaved people lived in this particular room, but we wanted to make it part of every visitor's experience. Now, we did pick this room for a reason. As you can see, it has a very poor roof line that would be uncomfortable for you to stand up in. There's also, in the far edge of this room that you can't quite see in this photograph, a very narrow and steep staircase that goes right down to where the colonial kitchen used to be. And enslaved people would have been doing that kitchen work. We also recognize that the attic above this room was another place enslaved people might have lived. And the dirt basement in the very bottom of this house is another place where slaves probably lived. This family had a lot of land around the property with barns and other outbuildings, and enslaved people might have also lived in those barns or other outbuildings. So now the public is inspired to imagine the lives of enslaved African Americans who lived in our house, who lived in our town, who lived in New York, not in the Civil War, but in the time of America's founding. And I ask us all to think, is there room in the story of America's birth for them? I think there has to be. Now, most Long Islanders favored the king. We were primarily loyalists on Long Island, but not the Townsends. And in 1775, Samuel Townsend actually joined a group of other New York patriots who were planning the revolution, but they were doing it in secret. So this New York Provincial Congress, which was like a satellite of the Continental Congress, for a year and a half were meeting in New York, and all of them were sworn to a solemn oath of secrecy. Robert Townsend's father wasn't a spy, but he was sneaking around quite a bit in the run-up to the Battle of Long Island. Now, we're in that time right before the Battle of Long Island. 1 month after the Declaration of Independence, in late August of 1776, Samuel, as a member of that Congress, was given a very important job. He was hand-delivering letters between George Washington in Manhattan and our biggest general out on Long Island, General Nathaniel Woodhull. Woodhull badly needed reinforcements if he was going to enter the Battle of Long Island. He was asking Washington for 500 soldiers, two regiments worth of men. This was also the very time when Robert was appointed commissary for General Nathaniel Woodhull. Some people think that Robert was not in the Continental Army, but he was. He was appointed commissary, but he never got the opportunity to serve. That's because right after those letters, the Battle of Long Island was lost. General Woodhull was horribly wounded by members of Delancey's brigade. He would later die from those wounds that became infected. And all of Long Island and all of Manhattan was abandoned by Washington, abandoned to the British. And so all of Long Island now had British regiments marching into our towns. And all of New York City became British headquarters. And when that happened, members of the Townsend family didn't flee. They and their household slaves stayed behind enemy lines. Now, in the fall of 1778, a large regiment of British called the Queen's Rangers occupied Oyster Bay. And their commander, Lieutenant John Graves Simcoe, made the Townsend house his home and his headquarters. And during his stay, Elizabeth's duties were extended to caring for these unwelcome guests, which included, in March of 1779, his good friend, Major John Andre, who came to visit our house and stayed for several weeks. Now, Andre was the British spy master, the top of the British intelligence operation. And Liz would have served both of these men in her job as a household slave. Young, intelligent, and beautiful, Elizabeth was reportedly quite popular, despite her slave status. She was described in some of the documents that the East Hampton Library owns as being too fond of the British officers and too fond of company. Now, at this very time, a network of Patriot spies was beginning to form to send vital information to George Washington. They were founded with this cousin of the fallen general, a man from Setauket named Abraham Woodhull, who was given the alias of Samuel Culper. Now, right when this group began in October of 1778, Woodhull reportedly excited to Washington that he was, quote, engaging a faithful friend, one of the first characters of the city, to be his informant. This valuable new source of intelligence, I think, was likely the Townsend's 25-year-old son, Robert, who was living and working in Manhattan with a store on Hanover Square, working as a merchant and renting a room in the city at Woodhull's sister's house. Just a few months after John Andre had visited our house, May 18th of 1779, so it was just this very week, one member of the Townsend household left as the Queen's Rangers departed Oyster Bay. She was hidden somewhere in their caravan of soldiers, horses, and wagons. Liz escaped with the British. Now, 1 week later, Robert wrote a very interesting letter to his father, Samuel. He confirmed the regiment's location just beyond Kingsbridge, that's at the northern tip of Manhattan, and he blamed Liz's escape on Colonel Simcoe. He also urged his father not to try to recover his valuable slave, but to just write Liz off as a dead loss. Now, Robert and the rest of the Culper spy ring were supplied with a steady stream of intelligence from a variety of sources that included an unknown and mysterious woman referred to only a single time by the code name 355, who had access to information in a role that seemed to arouse no suspicion, a woman who could help them outwit them all. For the next year and a half, Robert risked his life as Samuel Culper Jr., sending coded and invisible ink messages to Washington. Over 190 of these Culper letters still exist, and just as many were probably destroyed by the spies to help them avoid detection. The punishment for being caught as a spy was death by hanging. Meanwhile, Liz, during the war, was enslaved in Manhattan by a British officer. Now, the name of this British enslaver remains a mystery, but several entries in Robert Townsend's ledgers, again out at the East Hampton Library, show that he did have contact with Liz. He may have told his father to just write her off, but Robert knew exactly where she was. Now, following the unraveling of Benedict Arnold's treason plot in the fall of 1780 and the hanging of John Andre, Robert went into hiding for several months. When he returned to Manhattan, he quickly moved his shop from down here at Hanover Square to a place that was much more out of the way over here at Peck Slip, because Benedict Arnold had dozens of suspected spies rounded up by the British, and Robert knew a lot of those people who had been arrested. He wrote in one of his spy letters at that time, "I'm happy to think that Arnold does not know my name," but he was very afraid that he would get caught. And so, fearing his identity would be revealed, he stopped writing his Culper letters, and he reverted to audible reports only. He would then meet Woodhull in the outskirts of the city and just tell him his intelligence reports in person. Near the end of the war, Elizabeth became pregnant. And she faced imminent evacuation to Canada with this loyalist master. Believe it or not, she reached out to Robert to ask for his help so that she could remain in New York. She asked Robert to purchase her. And he agreed. In August of 1782, Robert took Elizabeth into his home and he wrote his final spy letter to Washington. Now, we're in February of 1783. On February 19th, she gave birth to a child. I believe it was a son named Harry. Documents later describe Harry as mulatto. Now, that's an offensive term, but what it means is mixed race. So, 6 months after that, when the baby is 6 months old, in a misguided plan he would later deeply regret, Robert sold Elizabeth and her baby to a recent widow. This woman, named Anne Sharwin, actually knew Elizabeth, and Elizabeth agreed to this arrangement. But the purchase came with some special conditions. Elizabeth would never be sold out of New York. If Anne wanted to leave New York, she was supposed to contact Robert and buy Elizabeth back for the original price. However, 1 year later, the widow remarried, and this new husband, a wealthy merchant named Alexander Robertson, gave Elizabeth attention that caused a, quote, derangement and separation in this new marriage, which ended almost as soon as it had begun. And then, either for money or just out of sheer spite, this Alexander Robertson character sold Elizabeth South to Charleston, South Carolina, and he sold her down there without her child. She was transported on a ship called the brig Lucretia. This ship was operated by a notorious man named Captain Tinker. And this villainous character had actually become well known for kidnapping many, many free Black people in New York City. And so when Captain Tinker would bring his boats into port, the local papers would sometimes print warnings to free Blacks in New York to be on their guard that Captain Tinker was back in town. But Elizabeth hadn't been given her freedom, so she actually wasn't kidnapped. She was just sold, right alongside the barrels of rum and the crates of tea headed south. On the same exact day that Elizabeth landed in Charleston on the Lucretia, January 25th, 1785, was the very first meeting of the New York Manumission Society. This was an anti-slavery group that was founded by John Jay, and it had as its members Alexander Hamilton and Hercules Mulligan, as well as Robert Townsend, who was the only member of his family to join this fledgling movement to try to end slavery in New York. But Robert had no idea that Liz was in Charleston, and her new master was a very violent man. His name was Richard Palms, and he had already secured a place in history. He was the instigator of the 1770 Boston Massacre. 8 years after the Boston Massacre, he made history again when he served as John Adams' personal bodyguard during a voyage that Adams took to Paris to meet with Benjamin Franklin. Now, you're not going to believe this, but it's true. Unbelievably, just when Palms was delivering John Adams to Paris in 1778, Robert Townsend's older brother, this man, Solomon Townsend, was also there, and he too was visiting Benjamin Franklin. He was getting from Franklin this document we see in the middle, an oath of allegiance to America. These incredible moments of pass-through history, crossing and intertwining, just happened throughout Liz's story, and it really surprised me how it just kept happening over and over again over the 16 years. Now, 2 years after after Liz had been sent south, Robert finally discovered that she was down there. And he wrote to these two Charleston business contacts to help get Liz back from Charleston, back up to New York. And that's these three letters that the East Hampton Library has that are so important to my research. Now, each one of these letters is chock full of information, but the first one that was written in January 17th was written to these two merchants, Richard Lushington, you see his image up here, and a man who was born and raised in Oyster Bay named John Kirk Jr. In this letter, they're being asked to repurchase Elizabeth from Richard Palms and send her back to New York. And it gives the name of Richard Palms. It also gives the name of this man, Alexander Shiras, who held her bond. It talks about men named Hopkins and McLean, who brokered her sale in New York. And it also gave details about how Elizabeth had been born in the Townsend household and how she had been resold by Robert to this widow, Anne Sharwin. It also had some really heartbreaking details. Robert asks that they might purchase her warm clothing because in January, it'll be so much colder in New York, and he's afraid she'll be cold on the return trip. At the end of this first letter, he says, "We intend this as an act of justice." He's appealing to these two men to help. But then we get to the second letter, which is a few months later in March. The two men are actually going to refuse to help buy Elizabeth back. And this is Robert's return letter after having received this refusal from them. They're refusing to help, ironically, on moral grounds. They refuse to purchase a slave, even if it's going to help that person. Robert shares in this letter that he also has anti-slavery beliefs. And that was really important to my research to have that in writing. He says that his father Samuel will probably offer Elizabeth her freedom when she comes back. And then he gives this interesting side story that Liz has a sister, I believe it's a woman named Hannah, who has, quote, declined her freedom. And that gives us another window into the world of enslaved people and the choices that they had to make and wanted to make. Then at the end of this letter, they talk about a man named Adam Gilchrist, who they're going to write to next to see if he'll help. This next letter was written on the very same day, so Robert was very busy at work trying to help Liz. The man, Adam Gilchrist, is the person you see in this beautiful little miniature. He was a merchant down in Charleston, and he was an old family friend of the Townsends. Now, this letter reiterates everything the other two said. And it's interesting to see all those details written out again. But I put this quote up here and I want to read it because it just takes you to the heart of Robert Townsend's agony. It says, he's speaking of himself here in third person. "Our RT sold her. And as he is principled against selling slaves, is anxious that she should be repurchased and sent back, that he may return her to her original master, who we have reason to believe will give her free if she chooses to be so. If you have any scruples about purchasing her in your own name, we request you will do it in our names." If you try to unpack that, it just is so crazy. He's talking about selling her. He's talking about being principled against selling slaves. He's writing to people who are against owning slaves, and he's asking them to please go ahead and repurchase her in their name. It just takes you to the heart of this confusing time. Now, I believe that Adam Gilchrist did help bring her back, but the irony is that that same anti-slavery group that Robert had joined, that New York Manumission Society, by this time in 1787, had accomplished passing a law that forbid the importation of slaves from out of state. So that law actually caused her return to be illegal. She had to be smuggled back. But in 1789, I believe I found proof that she did indeed make her way back to Oyster Bay. This interesting document that was found by our town historian, John Hammond, shows the members of the Oyster Bay Baptist congregation in November of 1789. Now, right here next to Samuel Townsend's name is Elizabeth, a Black woman. And if you notice, it doesn't really say whether she is free or enslaved. On the next page of this document, we see his wife, Sarah, and his daughter, Sally. So if there's anybody in the audience that mistakenly thought the Townsend family were Quakers, they were not. They were Baptists. Now, 1 year later, we had the first census in America, the 1790 census. And in the 1790 census in the town of Oyster Bay, we can find this record, Free Elizabeth, a single woman who is free, listed as a worker, as a paid servant in the household of a very wealthy man named David Richard Floyd Jones. And here's what his house looked like, a gorgeous mansion in what's now Massapequa called Fort Neck House. So imagine that Liz is living here and she's working alongside both free Blacks and enslaved African Americans. And here's a room where she might have every day had to clean or serve or work in some other capacity. In fact, we even have photographs from before this house was destroyed by fire. Now, I like to think of Liz walking up these stairs or passing through these doorways, but this house is where her records end. And as much as I would love to know more, these are the last moments of her life that I have a record of, for being in this house. But what I can tell you is that in 1827, slavery finally ended legally in New York, and it had been in legal action for 201 years. Legal slavery ended in New York, ironically, on July 4th, Independence Day. So when you and your family are celebrating July 4th this summer, I hope you'll think about how July 4th is New York's Emancipation Day. And so this is where I'm going to leave you. And I hope you'll read the book and you'll read about so many other details. The slave markets down in Manhattan, the people who were enslaved across the island, other runaway slaves that I talk about in the book, about the ads for enslaved people that appeared and what those meant, and so many other details that fill out Liz's story and the story of the Townsend family. And so now I've come to the end of the slideshow, but I hope you're going to have been thinking about Liz and you're going to think about the life of enslaved people during the time of America's founding. Most of all, I hope you've been thinking of questions, because I'm going to turn off the slideshow now, and I really hope that you'll have some good, interesting questions for us to share together.
Hi, Claire. Hi, everyone. This was so important. My sister-in-law is also joining us. This was so important for us to watch this. Our family name is Townsend, and we are from Oyster Bay.
Oh, I'm so happy to meet you.
Yes, we have been trying to make that connection. I'm looking at our tree on Ancestry.com, and the last Townsend that I can see is a Mary Townsend that was born in the 1830s. My sister-in-law found, we believe, an Isaiah Townsend. How do we get in touch with you, Oyster Bay, DNA? How do we do this to kind of, you know?
So I have to ask you, Lori, are you friendly or related with Anthony Townsend?
No.
Oh, that makes me so happy.
Oh.
Because he is a person who I'm very well acquainted with and friends with, and he is a Townsend from Oyster Bay who can reach his history back to the era of slavery. And so he can help connect those dots for you. Can you lift up my whole chair maybe? Yeah, so you can contact me through that website, or you can email me. Yeah, so espionageandenslavement.com is the website, and go in that contact button. And I can't wait to talk to you and see if I can connect some of the dots for you.
Thank you. I am going to mute myself and do that right now.
Oh, yes. I am so happy to meet you.
You know,
there is a whole lot of Townsends who are African-American who are connected to the Oyster Bay story, and they are absolutely 100% part of this book. Yeah.
So again, I'm going to put the link for Claire's website with the book that she and Tiffany wrote here in the chat. And, you know, those of you that have like specific personal requests, feel free to go that way. And this is very exciting, Lori. So thank you.
Lori, you're making me almost tear up to think that I can connect you to Anthony Townsend. That makes me so happy.
So the next question, I believe, is going to come from John McAuliffe. John, if you could unmute and lower your hand. Thank you.
Okay, right. All right. Well, first of all, this was extraordinary. Who's going to make the movie?
Well, we're working on that, John.
Good. Well, you certainly should. I mean, it's a fascinating reflection on American and local history, but especially in this moment, a much larger story.
You know, also, I just wanted to say, before I get to your next part of your question, that Vanessa Williams wrote the foreword to our book, and there was a very good reason for that. Vanessa, just like Lori, can trace her heritage back in Oyster Bay, her African-American heritage, to the era of slavery. And so her people are working on that idea of making this a larger story, a story that's accessible through film or through some other medium.
More at a more modest level, I hope that you will come and do the presentation at the Suffolk County Historical Museum here in Riverhead.
I would love to, please.
I mean, this is exactly, tomorrow I'll talk to them and suggest that they invite you.
Yes, and at that same web address, you can email me directly and we'll see.
Yeah, well, and I thank the East Hampton Library for launching it, because I think it's, so my question is,
okay,
the reference you made to Quakers, what was that about? What was the assumption?
You will find in almost every book about the spy ring that Robert Townsend and the Townsend family were Quakers, and they just were not. That was just an erroneous thing that was repeated over and over again. Now, if you go all the way back to the first three Townsend brothers that came to Oyster Bay in the 1660s, in 1661, they were associated to the story of Quaker persecution, although they were not Quakers either, because two of the three brothers had signed a document called the Flushing Remonstrance, which is this early precursor to the Bill of Rights. And because they had come out defending the rights of Quakers to worship in their own homes, Peter Stuyvesant was really going after them. So,
well, and also there's a strong Quaker history in that part of Long Island. So
there is, and there are definitely Quaker family members that, I mean, Townsend family members that are Quakers. It's just that this particular branch is not.
Okay. Thank you.
It was all John Hammond's discovery of that Bible record. That was what really tipped that one over. I keep saying, though, that we have a Quaker hangover at Raynham Hall. We keep like trying to think of them as humble people, plain people. It's like, no, they were rich merchants. They had fancy stuff.
Quakers, the famous saying is, they came to do good and did very well.
Oh, well. You know who was a Quaker, though?
Tend to be fairly upper middle in both then and now, because of the seriousness and the not throwing money away for drink and carousing. And
John, when you read the book, you'll be interested to read about a Quaker who is in that story, and that's that man, Richard Lushington, who the three letters from East Hampton, who they're writing to. He was a Quaker who not only served and fought in the Revolutionary War, but he commanded a group which was called, quote unquote, the Jew Company. He commanded a company that was compromised of Jewish people. And so he's got a very interesting history, this
man, that's your
Richard
next
Lushington.
Book. That's your next
he's just going to find his way in this book.
We do have another question, John.
That's fine. Thank you very much.
So our next question is actually from Lynn Farrow. She would like to know where the portrait of Liss came from and how was the documented. Lynn, do you want to unmute and explain this a little further? The documented part of your question?
Let me just answer the portrait part first. This portrait is not old. And it is not a list per se. It is an artist's interpretation that was just made for me. You can see it behind me here. It was made a few years ago by an artist who I commissioned in Colorado, a woman named Lindsay Levine. I know that enslaved people would not have their portrait painted, but I wanted a portrait of Liz, and I thought that she deserved a portrait, you know? She deserves to be remembered, and she deserves to have a face, to have an image. And so I just did a little looking around at other contemporary portraits of African Americans of that era. And I drew from inspiration some women who are alive today who I find strong and powerful. And after talking to this artist, she came up with this painting for me.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I think the next question that I see is from Barbara Grimes. Barbara, I'm going to ask you to unmute, and I'm going to lower your hand.
Hi, thank you. Very great presentation. One question. Did you think it was possible that Liz might have been 355 in the Culper spy ring?
The reason why I feel she's a contender for that, and I say contender because we can never know, right? Mm-hmm. There's just this one mention in this one letter. But the timing is really fascinating. That letter was written right after Robert had established himself as the lead spy in New York. It was also written right after Liz had escaped and come to live in Manhattan with this British master. And so what better way to find someone who's going to help you get information than to have an enslaved person who's virtually invisible, right? Yeah. So we can never really know who 355 is, but I just want Liz to be in the running.
And I would add that the letters, Robert's letters stopped within a month of Liz moving into his home. And so that's another aspect of the timing that was very interesting that I think kind of fed to this theory. When we wrote the book, we wanted to be very careful that we were not making assertions where mm-hmm. where we just couldn't know, where history doesn't necessarily tell us. So we do lay out several scenarios saying this is a possibility, mm-hmm. this is another possibility. But we explore this and say this is possibly something that could have happened, mm-hmm. and this is how the timing lines up. So we do leave it up to the reader to make that decision. But we lay the evidence in favor of considering it strongly. So, mm-hmm.
and it's the same when she escapes. You know, you could drive yourself crazy thinking about when she escaped and what it was really like, and who knew and what they knew, and who was helping her. So we lay out three different scenarios in that instance, and let the reader really decide what they think.
That's very fascinating. Thank you.
So I have another 355 related question from Lisa Gomez. She writes, do you draw any conclusions from Liz's relative fluidity in society in connection with 355? And Lisa, if you wanted to clarify any of that or add anything further, you're welcome to unmute as well.
You know, the idea that an enslaved person was able to move in and out of rooms and have contact with people that, frankly, others would not have had, really does give you a window into this idea that she could have been a spy. You know, we'll probably never be able to prove it, but I think it's a fascinating possibility because she knew John Andre and knew John Simcoe intimately. You know, you think about what an enslaved person would do. They would turn down their bed. They would get the bed warmer and warm it up. They would bring them their food. They would take away their chamber pot. I mean, they had intimate contact with these people that other people would never have had. And so if she was enslaved in Manhattan in a high-level British officer's home, she would be in the background. And if she made it her business to overhear things and report back to Robert what she had heard, it's perfectly plausible.
And we do see her showing up in Robert's ledger. Mm-hmm. And with no element of surprise, there's not like an exclamation point after her name where Robert says like, oh my goodness, guess who just showed up. Like it's in a very comfortable, casual, Liz was in the store, which just again kind of further lends giving that theory another look.
You know, the other thing you just reminded me of, Tiffany, is he didn't pay his father back for Liz when he first makes note of her existence. He doesn't tell his father, oh, you know what? Liz is here in the city, that enslaved person who ran away from you. He waits to pay his father back for Liz's value until after she's coming to live with him. And then he pays his father back. And the father notes very calmly, oh, yes, this is the money for Liz. There doesn't seem to be a fight over it or anything. So it's interesting.
I'm looking for any other questions. If there is another question, I'm happy to take one. If there's another audience member that wants to message or raise their hand, they're welcome. Alana or Elena, I'm going to ask you to unmute. I see your hand.
Hi, this was great. I was just wondering, do we know what happened to her son, Harry?
Yeah, unfortunately, most enslaved people did not have a last name. And in the case of Harry, there were several enslaved people in our area who were named Harry. And so it's very hard to know which of these Harrys that I found records of are her Harry. And so we know that Robert maintained control over Harry as an enslaved person in his father's household, until Harry was just a few years shy of old enough to become free, which was 21 years old at that time. Then Robert actually sold Harry to another person in this very unusual agreement, which again is owned by East Hampton Free Library. I believe you have that one, right? The obligation to manumit Harry. If you don't have it, then they have it in at New York Historical Society.
I don't know that one off the top of my head, but we can talk about it later.
Yeah. And so this is a very unusual document. Robert is saying, I sell you Harry for this amount of money. And if you do not free him on his birthday, which is exactly, you know, 2 years, 1 month and 4 days from today, on this exact date, you owe me $1,000, which in those times was like an enormous sum of money. I believe that Robert may have been trying to get Harry in a position to learn a trade. I believe he was selling him to a person who could teach him a trade in life. Because one of the requirements at that time, if you wanted to become free, you had to prove your ability to make a living. And it may be that Robert was trying to set Harry up for a successful manumission so that he could prove that he had a trade. When Harry was 10 or 11 years old, living at the household of the Townsends, when Robert was maintaining that estate, he actually gave Harry some presents of money, which I thought was interesting. He doesn't show records of giving all the enslaved people money, but he does give Harry some money for Christmas and for New Year's. And he gives another enslaved young man, Harry, Jeffrey. He also gives Jeffrey some money. So it's interesting.
I do have another question related to Harry from Lisa Mickey, who works at the library too. So Lisa, if you want to unmute and go ahead.
Hello. I read the book. I enjoyed it very, very much.
Oh, wow. That's great.
Thank you. Any idea who Harry's father was?
This is another one where we can only lay out the possibilities. I think it's clear that Robert cared about Harry and he was looking out for him. I mean, Robert literally went into Alexander Robertson's home and stole Harry and gathered him up in his arms and took him out and did not pay for him. That was an illegal act. He could be his father because we know from records that Robert made himself that Harry was half white. And so there's other possibilities, of course. She had a British master. That could have been the father, or it could have been another man who got her pregnant, who was white. So we don't know. But I think, again, it's possible, maybe even probable, that that Harry could be his son.
And that's another case where, because we didn't know, we tried to lay out the possibilities in the book and let the reader see, you know, the math does work. Liz does show up in Robert's ledger, you know, roughly 9 months before Harry was born. But then there is the other letter that says, you know, she was impregnated by her then master, but it doesn't say who then the then master is. So if you read that
sentence mysteries. Another way,
yeah, it can be interpreted. Saying,
it could be saying, Robert purchased her, and then she had a baby
at her master
in the home of her then master, which could be him, right? And that letter doesn't say that he is the father. It just says he's the master when she gives birth. So yeah, you could drive yourself crazy.
So do I see any other questions or hands going up? I see a hand from, this is Claire Pam's. I'm going to ask you to unmute, and I probably don't have your name right. I'm sorry.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm Mike Palero. And,
hi, Mike.
I'm a dinosaur as far as working the computer. That's why you see the different name there. it's an eye-opening account, and I think it's going to probably become part of a future history and textbooks and everything. But I'm just wondering, as a general perspective, what monies were used to purchase, not what monies, how much money did it cost in those days to purchase a slave? And also, what were the average wages of the poor or the middle class in today's terms in those days?
Well, I would say that we've got a couple of great records that tell us how much it cost to purchase a slave. The first slave that Samuel Townsend purchased that I found a record of was way back in 1749. He purchased a man for 37 pounds. So in that era, you could buy 14 cows for, no, 7 cows for 14 pounds. I think I found a record of that. So if you purchased a man for 37 pounds, it was a lot of money. When Lys is sold and resold in the time around the end of the Revolutionary War, her price is 70 pounds, but that's quite a few years after that other record. And so again, it's a lot of money. You think of it as the purchase of a car, like a new car, that kind of a purchase. So it was a significant amount of money. Enslaved people were often listed as some of the most valuable parts of a person's estate in their wills. They were that valuable. And then as far as how much wealth a newly freed African-American person might expect to have, I think it's telling in that 1790 census that most free Black people were not living on their own. Most of them, even though they were free, were still living in the household of white people because they didn't have the resources or the generational wealth to have land or to have the ability to have their own home. So in the early days of people's new freedom, they were still in many ways trapped. They didn't have the resources to really have a full life like they would have had without all those generations of enslavement behind them.
Yeah, the general belief on that score would be that, they couldn't wait to become free, but you're right, as far as how are we going to make ends meet in the new freedom was a very tough question for all of those slaves at the time. Yeah.
What you'll find when you read our first chapter of the book is a wonderful story. We have the story of Tom Gall. He was the first slave freed anywhere on Long Island. And he was freed not just in the town of Oyster Bay or even the village of Oyster Bay, but when he was enslaved, the property where our museum is located was owned by his master. So this man, Tom Gall, became free in 1685. He married a free Black woman. They had a 100% free daughter. They ended up purchasing her husband and freeing him, so their grandchildren were free. And as we see those people showing up in Samuel Townsend's ledger books over the next few decades, they are doing better because they have generational freedom. They have a structure and a backbone of family members who can help them, and they can own land. They can own crops and fields and orchards and cattle. and they become so part of the Oyster Bay community that they're not even listed as Black people anymore. Even though we know they are considered free for so many generations that they aren't even notated that way anymore.
Wow.
Yeah. Mike, you did a great job. Not at all a dinosaur. I just didn't want to address you with the wrong name. I suspect we may have some more questions in the audience. So if you are looking to ask a question, if you could either message or raise your hand, that would be great. I don't see anyone. There is one small point that I think you may want to address. I guess I'll go ahead and ask it just to make sure.
Uh-oh, did I forget something?
There's one little piece that you've shared a little bit of with me, and I thought one or the other of you might want to explain why the British would help Liss leave the Townsend family.
Yes.
And which British officers you think would have been involved with
Oh, them? Yes. I really didn't say enough of that, did I? Well, raise your hand if you saw the show Turn. Anybody see Turn? Well, I'm glad you didn't see it because it's not so great. Turn really portrayed Colonel Simcoe as a villain. And that's that binary way we always think of history, right? We got the good guys and the bad guys. And Simcoe's British, so he must be a bad guy. Well, the family didn't think he was bad. In fact, the Townsend family said of all the commanders who billeted in the house, Simcoe was the most honorable. And he really had some strong moral beliefs against slavery. In fact, Simcoe wanted to raise a regiment and command them in battle, a regiment of escaped American slaves, and he wasn't permitted to do that. But after the war, he was in Canada, he was the governor of Upper Canada, and he put into law a legal end to slavery in Canada. So when you hear about the Underground Railroad and the Civil War and American Black people trying to get up to Canada to become free, you can thank Simcoe for that. If it weren't for him ending slavery in the 1790s, way before New York, way before America, there wouldn't have been that safe haven up there. We actually found, and we write about in the book, that he helped several other enslaved people during the war escape as well. A man named Barney, who became a trumpeter in his Queen's Rangers, and an African-American couple who were tragically resold back into slavery by members of the Queen's Rangers when Simcoe wasn't watching. He got very, very upset about that. So you'll find some interesting stories about Simcoe, and I think you'll think of him in a different light.
Claire, I have two questions that have since come in, or at least two indications that somebody wants a question. One of them is actually, the first one actually came from Lisa Gomez, and then I think we'll go back to Mike. So is Lisa, are you able to unmute?
I am unmuted.
Great.
Hey, this is super cool. Lori and I have been digging into genealogy for a long time, so it's great to be able to, you know, put some names to the Townsend family. I've noticed in some of the really early census, like around 1870-ish, there's a column for race, and particularly in Oyster Bay, it's blank. What do you, any sort of like, was there sort of a sea change in terms of how people sort of thought about race then? Or is there anything we can draw from that?
I'm afraid that that could just be a bad census taker. Mm. That could be the result of a lazy census taker. Okay. What I've seen in Oyster Bay census records in the early days, and when I say early, I mean 1790, 1800, 1810, 1820, the really early censuses, is that in the very first one, they would indicate Black people by writing the word Black or by putting them indented in a strange way. Then they started having the column, and unfortunately, it was people's script handwriting who were making these records. And if you look at the way a cursive M for mulatto and a cursive W for white look, sometimes those two cursive letters looked a lot alike.
Well, we noticed that actually in another branch of the family that from that same area, that we also thought maybe that allowed people to pass if they moved to a different place.
Well, it could also just be the mistaken thoughts of the census taker. They were allowed to place a person's race just based on their own visual decision making of that day. And so I've seen records of people who are called Black, and then later they'll be called mulatto, and then mm-hmm. they'll be called Black again. And so when people of color are notated in these early records, it's really random sometimes how they're notated.
Yeah.
But I'll have to look into that 1870. I hadn't seen that record because I was in the past so far back.
Well, we're totally going to dig deeper into that. This is our special project.
You know what I have for you, Lisa, if the records you're looking at are Oyster Bay specific, there was a really neat record I found recently, and it's called the School Census. Have you ever run across that?
We have not.
Such great primary documentation, because this school census was people who were paying to have their, or they were enrolling their children in the public schools very early on. I'm talking about the 1820s and 30s. And in these records, people would be notated if they were Black people. It would be written next to their name.
That would be so interesting to correlate those with some of the census records that we found that sort of, you know, that talk about literacy, you know, can speak, can write, et cetera.
Mm-hmm. And in those early records, you're seeing who's the head of the household and how many children do they have enrolled in school. It doesn't mean that's how many children they have. That just means the ones that they've got in school.
If you could indulge me in half of another question, which you don't have to answer, is sort of the Native American population in area. And Lori, I think I'm right in this, that the Townsend side is also the side that was Native American from that part. Do you have any sort of, I got the book for Lori, but I haven't read it yet, I will have to say, but I will.
The Townsend specifically, I always see them identifying these enslaved people as being Black people. But that doesn't mean that people of color who were in our area were not sometimes Native American. And there were definitely many records I found of Native Americans who were enslaved. Hmm. I also found records of free Native Americans trading with both Samuel Townsend, selling him goods, and Jacob, his father. Jacob Townsend had a whole separate page in his ledger book for Indians, as he notated them being. Okay. So there's lots of neat Native American records that I've been tracking over the years, and I'd love to share them with you too.
Cool. We're all in.
So yeah, Lisa, if you and Lori need help getting in touch with Claire, I'm happy to help direct you to the website. You're welcome to contact me.
I believe Lori has already launched that.
Perfect.
And you know, I just want to point out to people that Native American people were often enslaved as well.
Right.
But on the other hand, when a African-American person would escape slavery, Native American communities would take them in and safeguard their lives and let them join in fully in their community and marry into their communities and really have a safe haven. And in a time when there was slavery in every one of the 13 colonies, where exactly were you going to go to be safe?
So
there wasn't anywhere to go.
Thank you.
Before we go back to Lori, I'd like to get Mike in because I know he was next in line for questions. So I'm going to let Mike unmute again, and then we'll come back to Lori.
Thank you, Andrea. Claire, I wanted to know, Tiffany, this doesn't have specific importance to Townsend, but for a general perspective, which I'm trying to gain from all this, slavery in my mind was a way of life since, I guess, cavemen. I correct me if I'm wrong. And now you're noting that the Indians were also sold as slaves. And I, for some reason, I think the Caucasian race was also in earlier days used in slavery. I could be wrong on that. But my more direct question then would be that recently I learned that England freed the slaves. Which slaves? You know, what color or what race, nationality? I don't know, but England was one of the first countries to ban slavery, and they were, of course, ahead of America in doing so. But I never knew that as a kid growing up, and in the school system. But what do you have to say about that?
Well, what did you want to pick up on anything, Tiffany? I mean, what comes to my mind immediately is just to remind everyone that slavery still exists, right?
Right. Yeah.
So there's still modern slavery in the world.
Absolutely. Well, and I think it's a very important to draw the line between what indentured servitude was versus slavery. So that, yes, you would have usually impoverished people coming from Ireland or, you know, places in England, various places in Europe, but especially Ireland, I think, coming over to the colonies, and somebody would pay their way, and then they would be in service to them for 7 years or 14 years, the length of their indenture. But then they were free afterwards, and obviously not what was extended to people of color. Was that there was not that terminus, there was not that contractual end date to what they did. So when we think in terms of slavery, I mean, that is very distinct from indentured servitude in the early American colonies. And I think that's an important line to draw, that we saw it's from the very first Africans that are brought to North America. From that point on, you start seeing more and more and more laws getting passed to ensure first it's, well, they're, you know, they're free to the end of their lives, but their children, or excuse me, they're enslaved to the end of their lives, but their children are born free. But it's no, any children born into slavery are also free. And so the laws continue to compound to make sure that the boundaries around what was allowed to them became more and more restrictive. Mm-hmm. And so I think that codification that you see shows that those terms, people were scrambling very quickly to establish, no, when somebody comes over here and as a slave, that is set, that is for life, which was, again, very different from the conditions of indentured servitude, where there was a clear contract, there was a clear agreement between the parties.
Just imagine having a child and that baby from their first breath is owned by the person who owns you. And that was the situation of enslaved people here. And it was always through the mother, you know, whoever owned the mother, when she would have a child, that child was then owned by her master. And so Samuel Townsend owned many slaves because they were born in his household. His oldest son, Solomon, was given two slaves as a wedding present. And those two people had seven children. And so his son now had seven more slaves. So you see how it compounded, as Tiffany was saying.
So, Mike, I'm going to move this on if Claire and Tiffany are okay with that, because I do have another person waiting. We mute Mike and then unmute Lori and lower her hand. And let's see. Lori, are you unmuted now? It looks like
yeah.
You.
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Go ahead.
So first of all, Tiffany, thank you for making the distinction between indentured servitude and slavery. I think that's a part of history that we don't talk enough about, and it's a narrative that likes to get spoken in terms of a false equivalency. So thank you for making that distinction. Claire, the question I wanted to ask, and it was kind of back to Native peoples of Oyster Bay. Another part of our family tradition is that is there a nation, the Shinnecock Nation, out in Oyster Bay? Because I think that was who we were kind of told part of our ancestry is from.
You know, I don't want to overstep my knowledge base.
Okay.
So I don't want to characterize the tribe or the tribal connections there. But I will just tell you this amazing story that I found. There was this family, and the chief, the one of the leaders of the area, was named Arumpus. That was, anyway, the anglicized way of saying his name, Arumpus. And he was one of these several important chiefs of the Oyster Bay area. And I watched this name turn from this chief into John Rumpus. So his last name got shortened down. And then this Rumpus name shows up in a couple of different places, along with a woman named Betty Rumpus. And they go from being this important chief who's given this place of respect down to just maybe two generations later, a man who's being checked into the poor farm, the poorhouse, named John Rumpus. And they're forcing him to wear English clothes. And they're paying a woman in the town to make him a suit of clothes to wear. This man, before he's put into the poorhouse, has made his life often a swamp, shoe swamp, because it's the only place, it seems, he can live and be left alone. And so you see him trying to separate himself from this culture and have his own private life. And he keeps getting drawn back in and being pushed down into a life of poverty. And so in just a few generations, this story goes from this great height down to this tragic place. And I don't know if that's the experience of everyone, but that one story that I followed, I just found it to be very sad and telling.
Just because I am getting some messages in chat from more than one person, actually, I am going to add that there is a Shinnecock Nation or Shinnecock Indigenous people that are associated with the Southampton area. There are some other people that are much more closely associated with the Oyster Bay area. And I would suggest a wonderful resource from another one of my recent presenters, Jeremy Dennis of jeremynative.com, who actually has wonderful maps connecting specific areas.
Oh, good. Thank you for doing that.
Like down to the local site and place with Indigenous people. So let me just throw that in there.
But I would just love to say that although I'm not an expert on any of those topics, I would love to share my research that I've found with people that are more expert in that. Because the more we can share our documents and the more we can get our research flowing across lines, I don't want to silo anything I've found in my computer. I want to share it with other people.
So do I have any other questions? Because I know it's getting a little bit later, but I don't want to leave anything important out. And I would like to make sure that Claire and Tiffany are able to wrap up in a timely fashion tonight, but I don't want to deprive anyone of questions.
I just want to say, while we wait and see if anyone has anything else to say, how grateful I am to you, Andrea, and to all the staff out there at East Hampton Library, because the help that you've given me over the years has just been so welcome. Honestly, I would email them that I wanted to see a particular document, and they would instantly scan it and send it to me in brilliant clarity, and I could zoom in and see everything. And just the way you can go on their site and you could just flip through these ledgers as if you're holding them in your hands. It's truly amazing. So
librarians and archivists really are the reason that books like this are able to happen, because they have become repositories of these forgotten pieces of history. And so thank you all for the work that you do in preserving history so that stories that haven't been told but need to be told can be brought to light.
Mm-hmm.